Welcome to the checkpoint. On our checkpoint tonight is Mumu Sabali, the one-time Secretary General and Head of Civil Service at the time of President Jame. For more, follow Ablaisi on this interview.
Mumu Sabali, welcome to the checkpoint.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Good. You said former Jame employees are equal, but some are more equal than others. What do you mean by that?
I didn't actually say it. I did a post on my Facebook timeline that all former Jame employees are equal, but some are more equal than others. That's what I said.
What do you mean by that?
Exactly what I said. You know, I'm a poet, so that's what I said. And people had their interpretations of it.
And what is your interpretation?
Well, it is what it is. It looks like a lot of people served under former President Jame, and some people are deemed unfit to be of service to the nation, whilst others of the same category are picked to serve the nation now, in a nutshell.
Are you referring to yourself?
Not quite.
Mm-hmm. You work under the former president.
Yes, I did.
Have you been considered for a job by the government?
Not necessarily, neither did I apply for one. Mm. But there are many other people out there who I think could be of service to the current government.
Mm. But do you have the right to pick and choose for the current government?
I never said I have that right.
Did you imply it when you say...
No, I didn't.
When you say some are equal, but some are more equal?
No, I didn't.
Mm. You did not?
Yes. This is my post. It's a post. I'm a poet. Yes.
Good. You used to wear many hats. You were once a very powerful guy. You've been director of budget. You've been the secretary general. You've been director general of GRTS. And you've been the managing director of the Observer.
MashaAllah.
Now, what I do now?
I'm a consultant. I have my own consulting firm, Pensden Consulting. And of course, you know, I'm a writer and I'm a motivational speaker.
A motivational speaker?
Sure.
What does that mean? In simple language, what does that mean?
As somebody who talks to people and lectures to inspire and motivate people to become their best selves and to guide businesses to become better performers.
Okay, when it comes to become best, you've been tried for abuse of office. How does that tie with being a motivational speaker, inspiring people to do the best?
Who tried me for abuse of office?
The former government.
The former government. Yes, Jame. You know how many times you've tried people who've been the best of the best in this country?
So what are you trying to say?
That question is a non-starter.
What are you trying to say?
Yeah, Jame's trial is just bogus, especially the one against me, and Jame himself knew it.
But
I was tried alongside these charges for even delaying a vice president's flight. I was tried also for encouraging Social Security and Housing Finance Corporation to fund a youth development project. And during that trial, Jame gave about $4 million to a Senegalese wrestler. So, it's a non-starter.
Your opinion of Jame, as stated now, doesn't tie with your relationship with him. This was a guy that we worked with happily. So now you want to say all these trials are bogus. What are you telling us?
What do you mean by I worked with him happily? It looks like you were inside.
You were at one time his secretary general.
Yes.
You were one time secretary general of his party, the APRC.
Very well.
You must be happy in those positions.
Well, not necessarily. It's a job I had to do, and because of my background and my training, when there's a job to be done, I just do it.
Yeah, but being the secretary general of the APRC was not a job that you must do. It's a job that you chose to.
It's a job I was appointed to do. I never applied for it. To answer your question, Jame had his bad sides, he also had his good sides. So I enjoyed the good side of him and tried to manage his bad sides. And after all, there's no perfect human being.
Excellent.
I had a job to do and I did it.
Yeah,
I could.
Okay, we move on. When you were at the Observer, some people allege that you brought the economy of the company down by coming up with Observer Lite that never worked. What is your response?
Well, I think it's bogus and it comes from those people who didn't want to work. Observer was already in a deep mess by the time I came over. I think the debt level was more than $12-13 million. And we continued. We became more relevant to the Gambia and abroad when I was there. I created Observer Lite as a subset of Observer. It's a
Was it successful?
Fantastic. Within 3 months, we were able to get like 20,000 followers on Facebook. And for once, during a very long period, young Gambians were able to connect with Observer. I think it was one of the greatest achievements I've ever registered as a professional.
So economically, it was successful?
Well, we just started, and you can't judge whether a particular entity is successful or not within 3 months. What happened was, when I was fired, well, as relief of my appointment as MDF Observer, the team that came in could not connect with the vision, and they dropped Observer Lite to the disappointment of many young Gambians, especially the creative youths who were being featured for the first time in a magazine in the Gambia. And these youths actually wanted to do a protest to bring back Observer Lite, but I had to tell them to put it off.
These people could have just been your supporters, not necessarily representative of the youth population of the
world. Well, we had every practically every young Gambian who mattered. In every, practically every field, every young Gambian who was doing something that mattered, who was creative, who was trying to do something to contribute to the progress of this country, was featured, regardless of any ties to me.
Good. During your time as the Director General of GRTS, there are still allegations, but at some point you were controlled by a cartel. There is a group of people who did influence your decisions. What is your response?
I didn't know of any cartel. Anybody who knows me, who is already knows I'm just about the most independent man in this country.
You were not aligned to any group?
No way. No. Anybody who knows me and my work ethic and culture knows that I don't side with anybody. If there is any room with Mamadou Sabari as a manager, the best get the best, regardless of ethnicity, relationship, or any other considerations. Yes, that is it, and I'm very proud of that record.
It seems you are never wrong.
I never said so.
Yeah, but it implies.
No, there's no human being who's never been wrong.
You are very self-confident.
Absolutely, I'm a motivational speaker and author, and I know my weaknesses, and I build on every
what are your weaknesses?
I have.
What are your weaknesses?
Well, I'm not in a position to enumerate them here, but one of my weaknesses, I know I can get angry pretty easily. I know that, for instance. What I'm telling you is that as a human being, I know my shortcomings, and I try to learn and improve on them, and I have this culture of lifelong learning.
Is that not true for everyone?
Absolutely, you know that's not true, Ablai. You know that for sure. You know that for sure. It's not true for everyone. Yeah.
It's only true for Sabari.
Not necessarily. I mean, there are people who are better than me at these things, and those are the people I look up to. I look at the best people, not just in the Gambia, in America, in England, all over the world, in the world of business, politics, sports, writing. I try to learn from the best of the best from every part of the world, knowing very well, constantly aware of my weaknesses as a human being. I have this culture of continuous self-improvement.
What are your biggest achievements at GRTS?
Well, GRTS, alhamdulillah, I think, of my long career, I think my stint at GRTS, it was such an honor to work with young, dynamic people. And I don't want to blow my own trumpet, but of course, this is teamwork, and every single person in that entity contributed in one way or the other towards the success. Maybe series, the Life and Times of Lalla Kebba Drame at Radio Gambia. MashaAllah, the impact has been tremendous. I mean, by the grace of Allah, I initiated the Hadath al-Usbu'i program, the Arabic news magazine program on TV. It was during my time that top-notch convo came up, and one of my fifth programs, Assignment. All those things popped up when I was there, and we did the July 22nd Development Caravan, one of my greatest prides to this day.
July 22nd Development Caravan,
yeah, one of the most innovative things we did. And all of these things, and that's why I'm giving credit back to the team, because most of these things, either I initiated, most of them I initiate, or the young team would initiate, and I say, go ahead, and I'll be giving them supervision and be pushing them, but like, I would not be on the ground.
Do you have any unfinished business at GRTS?
lots and lots of them. Like the Larotheba program was supposed to mature into a mega international festival that would showcase the beauty of our culture and sell the kora as an instrument that initiated, that originated in this country. My dream was to make GRT as actually the Al Jazeera of the sub-region, just like I did Observer Light. At Observer, my dream was to bring in GRTS too. That would do something a little bit more commercial and more relevant to the needs of young people.
So your dreams didn't work?
Well, so far so good. I mean, the if you know the way and manner, of course, I left the institution. I didn't have enough time to roll out all the intended programs.
I'm going to be personal here. What does he as somebody is aloof and arrogant?
Yeah, well, it's normal. It's their opinion. You know, I think, mashallah, la quwwata illa billah. I'm a high achiever by all standards anywhere in the world, by the grace of Allah. And especially if you are somebody like me who's constantly in the limelight, you will get haters and you will get detractors. But the point is, you go to GRTS, ask them which director general in the history of GRTS came into their newsroom playing football with them, doing high fives, and, you know, which director general has ever put up a tripod on his shoulders and gone down into the bushes to shoot programs for them. We go around town, from Koina to Katon, anywhere I'm called, I answer to those things. And I'm not much bothered about what people think about me, but I have my principles and I am assertive. And I'm blessed with a level of self-confidence for which I have no apologies for anybody.
We go back to your days as Secretary General. You once read a statement on GRTS,
yes,
saying unhelpful things about a particular ethnic group. Why did you do that?
Well, I'm glad at the way you framed it. You said I read a statement. I mean, this has been a contentious issue, especially from my haters and potential detractors. They actually say that I made a statement, not read. But the fact of the matter was, former President Yahya Jammeh wrote a statement in which he made some unflattering remarks about.
He wrote the statement?
Handwritten. You know, normally Jammeh would actually call you and.
So he wrote that without any supervision?
With his own handwriting, and it was typed and it was labeled official Gambia government statement. And I, as Secretary General, he asked me to read it. We tried to dissuade him from actually issuing out that statement, but he insisted, and it fell to me as Secretary General, just like other Secretary Generals read statements on behalf of Jammeh, on behalf of the Gambia government, actually, at their time. I read a statement. I'm not happy with the statement. I don't endorse it. And I think it's
what do you feel is when you are reading that statement?
Well, I remember this very well. Some of the commentators online, they said that my body language actually did not tell you the statement, and that's the truth. It wasn't a statement that I endorsed. And recently,
could you not have said no?
Well, on Jammeh, you know better, Ablaisi, especially under the circumstances, you could not have said no. If I said no, I would not have been sitting down here.
Do you have any regrets for reading the statement?
Absolutely. I mean, I regret.
Is an apology necessary?
Well, I mean, to the effect that I happened to be in that position at that material time and happened to be the vehicle to have read. But to that extent, yes, I do apologize to anybody who was offended, but I don't take responsibility for that statement. It's not my statement. And like an Zara recently said, anybody who knows Mamoru Sadari would know that I would not insult any other tribe, talk less of my own tribe, because by the grace of Allah, I'm a cultured human being from a cultured family and a cultured tribe. It's not me.
Can you formally apologize in this program?
Absolutely. I mean, absolutely. I do apologize to anybody who took offense to that statement, whether you belong to that ethnic group or not, and especially to people who know me and love me and were disturbed by the statement. I do apologize for any inconveniences caused.
There's something of a disappointment, a man of your character, self-confidence, being forced, I would say, to read a statement that you don't believe in.
Well, that was Jammeh, and you know the thing about Jammeh.
Yeah, but you could have said no and nothing would come out of it.
Mr. C, I was Secretary General, I knew what was going on. Everybody was kowtowing to Jammeh. If everybody took their stance against Jammeh for the first,
you could have been the one to make a difference.
Well, yes, at that age, with that experience in that office, unfortunately, it was not me. There are actually professional institutional bodies that never took the right steps to stop Jammeh. If the right steps were taken in the beginning, he would not have been here for 10 years. But in addition, I was in office and I saw America, United States of America, global superpower, come down and count out Yahya Jammeh, who is Mamoru Sadari. I may be brief, but I'm not foolhardy. I would not commit suicide.
No, but was it suicide? If you say you
know, it's not suicide because you were not there, you didn't know. There are people, I don't want to mention names, who work with Jammeh and they are no more. May Allah have mercy on them.
Okay, we move on. In the first place, how did you get that job? The job of
It just happened.
How did it happen?
I just sat down one day and I was called to the office of the president and handed a letter appointing me secretary general. That's it. Just out of the blue.
Some are saying because you are writing letters in the newspapers saying good things about
letters,
the former government.
I never wrote any letter saying any good thing about that government prior to that. No letter.
And you never wrote anything in the media saying sweet things about the former government.
Well, I've been in the media on records saying good things about the former government, thanks to GRTS, because we recorded my valedictory statement in 1999 and we played it for more. We took excerpts of it that would please Ghana, you as an institution pleasing Ghana, using my excerpts and played it for almost a decade. And I had no qualms about that.
We are happy with that.
I'm not going to say I'm happy. I'm not angry with it. I'm not protesting against it. Because that's one thing about me.
Would you like a repeat of that?
I would not mind any good thing that I said about Yagana and his development trajectory, and it was mainly about development and especially education. Things I said that his government did XYZ, bringing university education, stuff like that. If you played it today, I'd be more than glad. I have no regrets about all the good things I said.
What was the most difficult challenge you faced while Secretary General?
Of course, the most difficult challenge was actually to get Yagana to do the right thing and to stop him from making some of these really incendiary remarks about Gambia, about Gambians, especially the opposition, and also incendiary remarks about our foreign partners. There was a lot of success, to be honest. There was a lot of success. Occasionally, if he's in the right mood, he wants to do something, you come and appeal. I remember when Goodluck Jonathan visited, he was in Guinea-Bissau. The time he gave us, he kept pushing the timeline and he wanted to ask him to cancel, and by the grace of Allah, I was able to convince him and other things. But it was very difficult to convince former President Jammeh about anything, and there was always a risk element.
Why do you think that was so?
Because President Jammeh is President Jammeh, built and created by a system. Gambians created him. It didn't happen overnight. And I think he was a very peculiar individual.
Isn't that a bit simplistic for everyone to be blaming President Jammeh?
I'm not blaming him for anything. I'm just telling you that this guy was a complex human being.
Not only him,
there was a whole system.
What I'm saying is, the people who worked with him, will always tell you, President Jammeh this, President Jammeh that.
I'm not saying that
actually.
I am saying the contrary, that it was a system that created him. That's what I'm telling you.
We are all part of that system.
We are all part of that system. Like I said, UGR, he has used my speeches to build his.
Yeah, but is it not high time to move on and stop blaming President Jammeh and acknowledge that?
Who is blaming him?
You are blaming him.
Okay.
You are saying President Jammeh.
I think it's the system that created him.
It's the system that is blaming
him still.
Did you dismantle the system?
For me, the system is still here.
The system is still here.
I can tell you that.
In
so many forms, I don't think this program would allow me to go into the details of that. The public service, for instance, that was working on a Jammeh system public service. A lot of the people in office now work with the former government either directly or indirectly. So we have a job to do to bring about a complete sociocultural shift, especially those of us who are opinion leaders and movers and shakers in Gambia.
Have you started that?
I've always been on it. I'm sure you've seen me in the media talking to young people about patriotism, and instead of laying all responsibility on government and calling on young people to take the bold initiatives and improve their own lives, be more active in their communities, be more proactive in terms of their roles in national development.
Easy to say, you were once Secretary General of the APRC party.
Absolutely.
Are you still a member of
it? I am not a member of APRC.
You are not a member now?
No.
Why are you a member?
To the effect that I was appointed Secretary General of the party, yes, I was. I was fired and I left their party with them.
If you weren't fired, would you still be with them?
If I were not fired, to the effect that I was APRC, I guess that's a no-brainer. You can't be a Secretary General of a party that you are not a member of.
No, what I mean is, if you are still Secretary General, you can decide to say, I've resigned, I'm no longer on the part of you. You said you were fired and you resigned.
No, hold on. There are two Secretary Generals.
No, I don't mean Secretary General for the government, I mean the APRC
party. That's what I'm saying. You can't be Secretary General of a party of which you are not a member.
No, I mean, if you weren't fired as Secretary General of the APRC, would you want to just say, I've resigned? convoy, not even for the SAC.
You know, under the circumstances, I would not, because this is actually a party of really good.
You know, but John, you are exposed.
What do you mean?
You don't resign, you are exposed out.
How long was I there?
How long? Can you tell us?
1 year.
1 year?
Yeah. And you are that's not even enough time to learn on the job, talk less of resigning. Mm. Yeah. I'm not a quitter.
You never quit.
No.
You have to be pushed.
I'm not a quitter. I don't have to be pushed, but I'm not a quitter.
You can push many times.
If I am asked to go, I go. That's it. But I'm not a quitter. If there are problems, I try to work them out.
Are you still interested in your person?
I do follow them a lot, and I think they're a really interesting party. And there are really good people in the party, and sometimes I'm a bit disappointed at how hard people are actually bashing them, because I know good human beings, patriotic Gambians who love this country, who are still members of this party, and I'm still in touch with them. I have a lot of respect for them.
You come to the Sabali Leadership Academy. What is the idea behind it?
Well, it's just based on my role as a motivational author and speaker. SLA, yes, the acronym, we started during the time when I was actually going in and out of jail and had these legal battles with Jame. I was not working, but I still wanted to continue with what I consider to be my major purpose of inspiring and educating young people towards becoming progressive and responsible members of their communities in the country. So I just decided to, I floated a post on Facebook saying I'm hosting a motivational dinner, jeans and shirts events, and we had a young group of young people who came, university students mainly, young professionals. We had a chat and did a motivational speech, but the thing seemed to be so interesting they didn't want to go home. So I said, we'll cut it up here, we'll come back, and then later my wife told me, you know what, are you just going to leave these young people to just go like that? So we decided to set up something, do a lecture series based on one of my books, Instant Success, 10 Keys to Personal Achievement. And the idea was, after the 10-part lecture series, because the book is in 10 chapters, you would graduate them and take another group, but I guess the environment was so cozy and inspiring, they decided to stay. So we made it permanent, and we guys to start doing outreach programs like the annual summer youth camp, and I've been approached also to give motivational seminars in other institutions like Koto Senior Secondary Schools to try and teach young people.
Who is funding the academy?
It's personally my own funds from the beginning. Of late, we've had a lot of support from AfriCell in particular, and other well-wishers. Petrogas also contributed during our last summer camp, and we are the most grateful to them.
Now, if you are offered a job by this government, would you consider it?
It depends on what kind of job they give me. But let me just make this clear. I am open to any offer, whether it's from the government, the private sector, or civil society, any offer that would give me a role to effectively contribute towards the progress and development of this country.
Are you better within government or outside government? Do you think you can achieve more within or outside?
I'm really enjoying my life outside government, you know, definitely, really. And I feel that I'm fully employing my time in terms of contributing to national development. But I've been head of the civil service, and I know all of us have a role to play. All of us have a role to play, and I would actually encourage myself, other Gambians at home, even those abroad, that anybody who's offered a role to play in the new government should come in and try. I know it's not easy at all operating within the public service, and already we see some weaknesses that were in the past system that are also in this current system. But the fact is, there will never be a perfect system, but we all have roles to play, and I believe that anybody who's offered a role that they think they can actually play, they should.
You are a trained economist.
Yes.
More than 50 years after independence, mm-hmm. the Gambia is still ranked as a less developed country. Mm-hmm. What went wrong?
Well, I think we're talking about post-colonial, but a lot of the problems that we have, for instance, the structure of the economy was inherited from the colonial era.
Yeah, then you could have changed that.
Well, it doesn't happen overnight, because what happened is, as somebody like Khalifa Saleh would say, even our independence needs to be re-examined. How independent were we when we were dependent on loans and grants from IMF and World Bank, who continue to dictate our economic policies to this day? You know, so all of those issues are there, but I mean, I know where you're going.
But you are happy to take the dictation.
Well, no, we are not happy, because our hands are tied.
you can enter one.
No, no.
What has happened?
We've got names we pick from foreign governments.
You still have taken them.
Well, that's history. Could I, would I, should I, would not have. These are realities. But what happens is that in the Gambia right now, we have opportunities to transform our economy with the advent of the possibility of exploiting our petrocarbon resources. And I think the government should actually take decisive steps in terms of promoting
the examples you see in our
service industry.
And we encourage them when it comes to petrol.
Well, we can make a difference, and that's why I didn't just speak about that. Because right now we need an injection of resources, for instance, take care of domestic and foreign debt. But within that framework also, we could power the service sector, which I think the Gambia has a lot of comparative advantage.
If you were in charge, what would you have done differently?
When?
If you were the Secretary General now, what would you have done differently?
Well, to be honest, the position of Secretary General, you don't have too much of a free hand. You're working under a president, so it would depend on the direction the president would want to take. But
you have no way of influencing his decisions?
Well, absolutely. At least with the new president, he looks like somebody who would listen to advice. And I think that's a unique opportunity where you have somebody who actually kind of gives a free hand to public officials to do their job. I think this is a singularly fantastic opportunity for the Gambia to turn around the situation immediately. During Gambia, it was different. It was very difficult to do anything your own way. So I think this is a unique opportunity.
You envy the current civil service that they have such an opportunity?
Well,
you never had it?
Yes, I think it's a fantastic opportunity, not just for the civil service, even for the private sector and even the non-profit sector. Because there was a situation where even people in the private sector wanted to do stuff, but they were afraid of the albatross that was hanging over all of us. So this current dispensation, I think it's a unique opportunity, and anybody who would have had the opportunity to serve under this government, and you are well-intentioned and sincere, and these things cannot be taken for granted. Mm-hmm. It's a fantastic opportunity for one to actually exhibit one's own vision and also one's own mission in trying to make sure that what you actually believe in and what you want for your country within that capacity is done without much.
But we used to say the same thing in the former government, that the sky is the limit, the opportunities are here, everything.
We said the sky is the limit. We never said it. Only one person said it.
You never said it.
Yes.
The government never said it.
No, who said the sky is
the government
limit?
Said
no,
it.
You are trying to attribute it to the
public. The government said it.
No, it was Yahya Jammeh, not the government. It was Yahya Jammeh.
And most of you kept civil servants.
And he was about the only person who had the free hand to do whatever.
Every opening ceremony you say conducive environment, the sky is the limit. You've been saying it many times. Civil servant.
They are quoting the big man.
They are quoting the big man.
Especially to the extent of the sky is the limit. What I'm trying to put here is,
if they didn't know what they were saying at that moment, how would you trust them now when they say the same thing?
No. This is a completely different ball game. When it comes to issues like the sky is the limit, this was your journey, and it has specifically to do with education. What I'm trying to tell you here is, those slogans may have been there, but public officials did not have that room to actually do what they wanted to do. But now with this current dispensation, the environment is actually more conducive to individual Gambians and institutions actually doing what they are supposed to do without having the Janet Blame card to play. And I hope you will not use other excuses, because a lot of institutions use their agenda as an excuse for not performing. We have not seen any change in most of those institutions since Gambia left.
Thank you for being on the checkpoint.
Thank you for having me.